With them. She was always drawing, And I like to bust her chops every now and again, because in going through her artwork for this show, I discovered she drew something in 1966, one of the Rebels characters, and then I found a panel in ElfQuest from 1970, a dozen years, and she hasn't changed a thing. She hasn't learned to draw anything. And here's one with one of the Rebels characters hugging someone, and there's Lita hugging Cutter. And come on. Well, I suppose if you're going to swipe, swipe yourself. It's easier that way. Where has ElfQuest been in all of these 35 years? Well, you know where it started. It started right here with Fantasy Quarterly number one. This was an amazing thing. We didn't know it at the time, but in early independent comics publishing, this made quite a splash. It outsold anything else that was on there. And you know, nothing succeeds like success. Other people, other publishers got interested, and in particular, a company who collected the first five black and white issues that we did, and had Wendy color them, and put them out in a single glossy volume. Well, that was a breakthrough, because that volume went into bookstores. It was the first time that had ever happened, like Barnes & Noble, like anything else, and we're very proud of the fact that you can go into Barnes & Noble today and find an entire section devoted to graphic novels. Well, that started with this book. Once bookstores saw that people would come in and buy these things, they wanted more, and comics companies were perfectly happy to provide them with more. Well, with success, we decided, well, let's do some more ourselves. So we thought, we should become a real company, real grown-up company, so we did, Warp Graphics, and I thought I was being terrifically clever coming up with the name Warp. It has nothing to do with either Star Trek or perversion. It is an acronym, Wendy and Richard Pini. And we took office space, we got real office furniture, we got desks and chairs, and my God, we were trying so very hard to be grown up and legitimate. And we did for a number of years. We published a whole bunch of comics, sometimes as many as 8 or 10 titles a month, all of them related to ElfQuest, because we could, because the story was that big. And we did books as well of all different kinds. And in looking back, in our office, we have a couple of bookshelves, and everything in there is ElfQuest, one kind or another. So we either created it or caused it to public, and that makes us very, very proud. Well, this was all going on in the mid-90s. We were expanding as a company, engaging the services of other writers and artists. And the question may be asked, while we were all busy doing this, where was Wendy? Well, Wendy, along with Frankie, went to Hollywood. Because in the mid-90s, we had interest from movie people wanting to do an ElfQuest animated film. So she went there because she wanted to kind of shepherd the project. And we have had interest shown to us by a whole bunch of different studios. And in order to help promote this, to help it along, Wendy would provide all kinds of art. She did turnarounds, she did facial expression studies, these look just like animated cartoon sheets. And they're just wonderful. And Wendy was out there doing this. Here's Lita in different ways that she can move. And in fact, even did a little bit of animation herself just to show how Lita would do that. You know, the thing is, we're still waiting. We're very hopeful. We are eternally hopeful, because we know that but you know, it's not all just waiting. ElfQuest has made it to TV. We have made it to TV. There's a show called The Mighty Ducks from some years back. And in one episode, a couple of suspicious looking characters invaded the world of Mighty Ducks. And that's very much skyways up top and a green little cutter down at the bottom. This was an episode directed by a friend of ours who said hi through the tip of the hat of Mighty Ducks. Elsewhere.
You know, this is weird. I am signing the action figures with myself, and you're dressed as a cheetah thing. But this is actually like the most normal date we've had.
I am going to go look for a couple back copies of ElfQuest, which is something you should definitely do while you're still wearing a mask.
Yeah. Well, that was 90210's kind of snide take on ElfQuest, but any mention is a good mention. But the cherry on top of all of that was when ElfQuest made it to Big Bang. Years ago, that Johnny Galecki, Leonard, is an ElfQuest fan, and we're certain that he had something to do with the product placement there. And thank you, Johnny, wherever you are. One other place that ElfQuest has been is into outer space. NASA contacted us back in the late 90s. One of their experimenters had an experiment that he wanted to perform on in space in weightlessness, and the title of the experiment was Enclosed Laminar Flames, E-L-F, ELF. He also happened to be an ElfQuest fan, so he wrote us and said, would you design a mission patch for us? And,
cool.
Heck yeah. And Starfire has been to outer space on the shuttle, and Skywise is kind of myth because he hadn't been yet. And he would really like to go. And if you know anything about ElfQuest, Skywise is me, and I would like to go too. But that's as close as I'm going to get, but I'm okay with it. But you know, we've had our ups and downs. It's been a real interesting journey. But the thing is that the ElfQuest family is still strong, it is still together. And so before we move on to what's new, what's coming, let's take a minute and a half for some of what we think are really, really high points from ElfQuest. A Fan Imagining, a 5-minute film made really from love, that starred some amazingly beautiful and talented people. Here's our Nightfall. And you can see she really is self-sensed. and we had a wonderful Winnowill. who's a little taller. And if it looks suspiciously familiar to anybody on this panel, there's a reason for that, but we'll get to that. We have recently signed with a wonderful t-shirt company called We Love Fine. They are here at this convention. They do convention-specific shirts. They have a website, and they're doing a lot of different offices. And we're terrifically pleased with all that they're doing. I'm just going to run through very quickly. They're using some classic stuff. They're using some classic designs, making them look retro. They're doing some modern interpretations. They're quite interesting. They've got some wonderful graphic designers. But then, you know, I don't know if this is 8-bit video or South Park ElfQuest, but whatever it is, it's a lot of fun. But the cream of the thing is, have you ever seen the ElfQuest machine before? We had it, and we were just told that we would never have fun with this. And, you know. I love the awe reaction. And even. But this is the best. They have a lot of fun. And if he looks suspiciously familiar, there's a reason for that too. They have done a San Diego Comic-Con exclusive shirt. It's available here. So seek them out and look at all the wonderful stuff that they have. Now, in other news, we've been doing ElfQuest, and mostly it's Wendy and I. We've had some other people, but for 35 years, we've been doing ElfQuest. And Wendy has created a lot of very beautiful original art. And we've kept that in our offices for almost all of those 35 years. It's insured. There are alarms. There's fire alarms and so on and so forth. You know, what happens if all the insurance in the world isn't going to bring back something that's irreplaceable? So last year at San Diego Con, we were approached by Columbia University, by a wonderful lady who I wish could be here. She's here at the con, but she's working the Eisners tonight. How dare you? But she arranged with us to donate all of Wendy's artwork to the Butler Rare Book and Manuscript Library at Columbia University. They have a graphic novel program. And it takes a heck of a load off our mind. It will be there for years and decades and centuries to come for people to study. Butler is a wonderful place. It goes up many levels. It goes down underground. It's one of those wonderful libraries that has just miles and miles and miles of stacks. And if these stacks look familiar to you at all, it's because they have been visited before. When the Ghostbusters were hunting Slimer, it was in those stacks. And we know what he was reading. Okay. All of this is, you know, cute. Thank you, Slimer. But what you really want to know is, where are the new ElfQuest comics? Where's the graphic novels? Where's the special editions? Where's the apps? Where's... And you want more, and you want more, and you want more. Because that's what you do. And you do it very well. Well, you know, how are we going to do all that? I mean, that's a lot of stuff, and we want to provide it. But, well, we're not going to do it alone. We started out, you know, very independent. We're independent, but we're not isolated. And we love working with people and partnering with people. And our first announcement is that next year, from a wonderful outfit called Fless Publications, they are here at Comic-Con as well. They do some of the most beautiful art books that you can imagine. And they're going to do two for us in partnership with us. One is an art book on the art of ElfQuest, and it's going to have stuff in it. You've seen some, but there's a lot you have never seen. And then the second one is very special to me. And that's a book on Wendy's artwork, in addition to ElfQuest. Because there is so much that you don't know about her, that you've never seen that she's done, and for the first time in forever, it's going to be in book form. And we're looking at that for probably later in 2014. But let's get right back to comics, because that's what we're best known for. We're going to do what it needs to get you new ElfQuest comic book stories. And we've always been willing to do that. You know, our history. In 1978, we were alone. We were scrappy, we were independent, and that's all we knew how to do. But we have learned how to partner. In 1985, we partnered with Marvel Comics to reprint the original Quest in color. And that got us newsstand distribution. A lot of you probably discovered ElfQuest through those Marvel Color editions. We're very grateful. In 2003, we partnered up with DC Comics. They did some wonderful archive editions, very, very beautiful. And now, you probably know, but in case you didn't, we have partnered with Dark Horse Comics. We have one condition that we haven't yet asked them. I mean, it's a great logo that they have. We think it needs just a little and they're willing to do everything that we would love them to do. New comics, new books, reprints, get our stuff back into print, apps for everything that is digital. It's all in the mix. The first thing we're doing with them is ElfQuest, The Final Quest. This is a story that has, we've known it's coming for all of those 35 years. Just to show you a few things, these were some of the images that were online. You may have seen that when we were previewing that online. It's the most beautiful, most sophisticated ElfQuest story yet. What's it about? Well, this. And yeah, You've never seen enough of a story like this before, and it's going to be a bumpy roller coaster ride that you're absolutely not going to be able to want to get off of. But even at that, ElfQuest is still about, and always will be about, family, tribe, togetherness, and that's what's brought us here, 35 years from 1978, and we're very happy that we can sit up here and share 35 years, appointed years, with you, because you are now our family, our tribe. So thank you very, very, very much for coming up to see us. This is just prologue. We can have the lights. And now I would like to vote a whole different color palette. I would like to introduce our panel for the rest of tonight's festivities. To my left, going this way, of course, is Wendy, who is the magic maker, the senior magic maker. Has been an ElfQuest fan forever, who has aided and abetted us in ways we might never have imagined. He's the one who got those first 26 or so pages onto Boing Boing. And he is going to be instrumental in a high-tech way, and we're working on stuff. Next to him are Winnow Will and I just blanked. All right, I'm on fumes here. Winnow Will and Nightfall, the two ladies who approached us and said, we would love to do a fan film of ElfQuest. Can we do so? And we said, oh yeah. Stephanie Thorpe and Paula Rhodes. David Mizjewski, who is, how would you give him in 25 words?
David represents, well, these are all our kids. Because they all got corrupted by ElfQuest at a very young age. But David is our assistant here at the convention, and we absolutely could not get by without him. But more than that, David represents, I think he really represents a lot of young people who grew up reading ElfQuest and then went on to do something with their lives that was expressive of that love. David also, through reading ElfQuest and of course many other interests, came to love animals very, very much. And he grew up to become a naturalist and a spokesman for the National Wildlife Federation. And he is now a television personality who demonstrates animals and speaks up for environmental issues on such shows as Wendy Williams and Conan. And so we raised a kid, became a celebrity in the cause of animals and wolves especially.
Which is something that ElfQuest has always been about. So, I would like to turn the moderation, who's the moderation up here? I mean, we're all extreme, but I'd like to turn the moderator's mic over to Rob. He comes to ElfQuest with some wonderfully outre ideas, and he's going to put us all on the spot to one degree or another.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
I'm Rob Beschizza. I'm the managing editor of a website called Boing Boing, which Richard recently just described to you. And like you said, I've always been an ElfQuest fan since earliest childhood. I think I found it when I was 9 or 10 years old, and I was in England, so we found it pretty differently to how many people in the United States. To how many people here found it, and it was, I believe it was produced by a company called Titan, so just distributed.
It was a reprint license.
Yes. And that was how it kind of manifested. It had been the first time around. That was Titan Books in 1988 was England's equivalent of the Barnes & Noble book, where ElfQuest found its way into mainstream bookstores. And that was when it found its way into mainstream bookstores in the UK. And like I'm sure a great many of you just saw it. The first time you saw it, you knew you saw something which was completely unlike anything else you had before or seen before. And from that moment, a part of your life, and it was a part of mine. And moving on 20 years or so later, I'm the editor of a website, Boing Boing, which is a kind of a cultural, countercultural, small board of stuff website. And we wanted to publish more things other than blogging and news and the kind of things that everyone associates with sort of websites and blogs. And I thought, wouldn't it be cool to publish an office? Wouldn't that just be a dream come true, just to be able to have that, be able to post that? And I asked Richard about the idea, and they thought it was a good idea.
It's one of the biggest blogs as well. You're being modest.
Being very
extraordinarily modest.
So that's where it started. We got to publish the first half of the final quest prologue. And just now we're looking forward to printing 3 months. So that's where I just kind of came in here. And now I guess.
Well, I would like everybody to look in their program books for Rob's magnificent article on ElfQuest.
That's what I was supposed to talk about.
Yes. You're pike after all, you're full of dream bearers.
So, So about 6 months ago, we ran a couple of items for Boing, which really delved into what the spiritual and mythological origins of ElfQuest are. And the first was by...
Could you speak into the microphone?
I'm sorry, I always do this. We ran some articles at Boing Boing a few months ago, one of them by Majid de Oost in Los Angeles, who Wendy said was the first person who had uncovered the code.
She outed us. She absolutely outed us. She did a magnificent review. You can see it on Boing Boing. It's still up. And she outed ElfQuest as a creation myth. She's the first reviewer to have recognized it. Yes, it absolutely is a creation.
It's the blueprint of all the different myths that you've seen. This is just a kind of a Joseph Campbell thing. This is something that reaches not just to the structure of storytelling, but to the way that the characters and the things that they think about, the things that they do, represent the most basic human needs. And that's where it comes from. That's what basic ElfQuest is. I mean, people call it a self-quest. Oh, you called it a self-quest. And that was what Marge's article was about. You can read that at one point. And then I got to write my own article about Boing Boing a couple of months later, having interviewed them in kind of great depth. And that was about some of the stories from the Victorian age and some in the early part of the 20th century. And if you think of science fiction and fantasy, we often think of maybe a few things from the Victorian age, such as Jules Verne and maybe a few others. And then we kind of jump to the golden age of science fiction in the 40s and 50s, where, and also, of course, Tolkien, who was working at the same time as the kind of classic science fiction pops. But one of the things that we've forgotten, and this was the thrust of the story, and you can read that on Boing Boing as well, is that there's always been a thread of utopian fantasy, which we've kind of forgotten about now, because the same themes were taken over and very well exploited by writers of science fiction and fantasy such as Tolkien and such as, everyone in here has read science fiction, and you know all your favorites, you all know what it is. But there's all sorts of very minor and odd writers from the Victorian age of earlier who wrote about fantasy as a personal journey to utopia rather than as a social journey to utopia. You think of utopian fantasy and utopian stuff, dystopian stuff. You think of Brave New World, you think of George Orwell, 1984. You don't think of things where it's really about a personal journey to utopia that exists inside you rather than outside. And ElfQuest was one of the first things to pick up that thread which had been forgotten by literature for 50 or 60 years. And I think there was a quote to be found from a historian. There's a quote to be found from when we were writing this from a historian and mythologist called Richard Gerber. And he was writing in 1976. And the book he wrote was one I'm sure that you hadn't read or been encountered, because it was the kind of thing that was read by academics and fancy universities in Europe rather than anything a human being wrote to read. But there's a line in it that really stood out. And I think the line was, if the utopian journey in literature is to grow, then it's to become a quest in oneself. And that, I thought, was just a perfect indicator of the kind of the moment in humanity's spiritual history that Wendy and Richard just tapped into without even trying. It was just there, it was waiting to be picked up. And I don't think, you don't have to see ElfQuest as some kind of fancy literary thing. You just have to see it for what it is, which is the journey.
Something
which is awesome. We've never really known what we were doing. When we started our business, we had no business sense, no business education. Wendy never took our lessons. She said we drew every day for them. But we learned and we grew. We made all the mistakes. We learned from them. We invented new ones, made them, learned from them, and it's a constant growing process. And as part of that process, I kind of want to bounce the ball over to Paula and Stephanie, because you are helping us now grow in ways and in directions that we could not do.
Before could you and Stephanie start talking, I'd like to ask everyone to scoot in, so everyone can enjoy this wonderful panel. So scoot in as far as you can.
Hey, my pass.
Right.
Standing room only.
Everybody get real, real friendly.
That's true.
You read issue 17. You know what. Let's get friendly.
Universally, they're all boys in
here. Thank you.
Paul and Stephanie.
Yes, we should. We do hope to grow in many ways. I think we announced in Variety in October on Election Day, which is fun.
Speak up, please?
Yes, I can. Thank you.
Yes,
We announced in Variety in October on Election Day.
November,
pardon me.
And I'm Canadian.
Thank you. that we have earned an option to be filming TV rights to ElfQuest. To hunt big game and have been to the lots of meetings. And to that end, I think ideally, what would you say, Steph, would be our goal?
Everything.
World domination?
World domination. That's maybe my winnowill, inner winnowill talking. Yeah. There.
I think
we would love to expand the brand and give all of you fans what you've been craving for 35 years. It also really touches our hearts when we see new fans. Discover ElfQuest. And so if we can assimilate everyone and make them ElfQuest fans,
and
we would love to do that.
This is a franchise. This doesn't need to just be one movie or one TV show. This has room to grow into so many different mediums and all the cracks and crevices to reach more and more people and storytelling. And so if we were to just make a wish and, I don't know, not give anything away, but hope for something, we would say that we would want to grow in all of those areas. Yeah. And have some very exciting things in the works.
If any of you bought ElfQuest t-shirts here or are going to buy them, you have Stephanie and Paula to thank for them.
One of the first things when we got the option was we wanted to give something immediately right back to the fans. And so we thought t-shirts would be great.
And we think we can move on them right away.
Exactly. And get them out there and get them to you guys and through the wonders of the internet.
And this ElfQuest trailer, I'm telling you, it has won prizes right and left.
We won quite a few festivals, which is fun. I just screamed that there was a right before the Princess Bride and a drive-in in LA recently.
Hmm. Electro-adjusted drive-in, which is great. Like,
it's great.
If you haven't seen this, and I hope everybody has, but for two of you in here who are skulking and haven't seen it, what's the website?
You can go to ElfQuestFanTrailer.com. You can see all the press and the pictures and otherwise. And I'm sure the first thing you'll notice, have you not seen it before, will be that it is an all-female version. We cover just the female characters from a particular point in time and stuff. Would you like to answer the question we've done a thousand times?
Yes.
Tell you what?
Yes. Well, we wanted to put our spin on it, and for us, ElfQuest taught us, showed us what it was like to be here, and gave us strong female characters that we could look up to.
Thank you.
So thank you for that. Push us into the entertainment industry.
We needed to put our own label spin on it because at the time, Warner Brothers had the rights to it. They no longer do. But that was our one reason behind our decision.
Exactly. And we also knew lovely, talented elves that we knew we could take out into the woods.
It went something like this on Twitter as we were brainstorming. Hey, Steph, have you ever realized Kathy Barron looks so much like Dushine?
Oh, yeah, she totally does. She really looks like Dushine. And Terry Sutters, if she was one, that would be great.
Oh,
back and forth.
And so we had about 37 female characters, and suddenly we're like, and who looks like Cutter?
Crickets.
That we know.
And then I started
that looks good with the shirt off.
Oh,
she's a good actor.
Chris Pine.
That would complain
about the cuts. Let's hold a casting session and make men take their shirts off.
Right men in to take their shirts off. We're not the smarmy producers of the internet. So, future us, we're happy for that.
Yes, and I guess it's good karma that we weren't smart.
Right, so we went with that, the all-female version for that particular endeavor, but yes, of course, we promise you moving forward, we would not do so without Cutter or Skyway.
Exactly.
We would ask of Stephanie and Paula is that they would become more energetic, more outgoing. Are too
soft-spoken, low-key. We have trouble with that. And I have to modify something I said. You know, they did this trailer for Love of Elf. They did this trailer 90% for Love of ElfQuest. The other 10% was the guys without shirts. Maybe 80-20.
But yeah, it was all love. We raised funds through you guys, through fans, on Indiegogo in a week. And pulled in all the favors we can, which brings us back to making going big or going home. This is an expensive project to do right, and we intend to do it right.
To put it in perspective, for people who have been like, oh my gosh, let's do a Kickstarter film. The most money Kickstarter has ever raised for any project would not pay for a wolf for a week.
Wolves are very expensive.
As you can attest, yes?
Yes, it's not, I think my mic's working. You know, for a living, works with wildlife, and as Wendy mentioned, I do lots of TV appearances where we have to book working animals. You can't just go into the forest and pluck a wolf out.
We try.
It doesn't work.
They bite.
So, like human actors, animal performers, or working ambassador animals, cost.
Union.
Yeah, they cost some money, a few grand. And so, I thought that your stand-in wolf was really good and accurate. So.
And we're lucky, and that's a sense of community too. Our wolf footage in the trailer was donated to us by a group of producers from another web series who could afford a wolf for half a day, one wolf. and that was Grease the series. If you want to check them out, there.
Stephen,
And they went to the sci-fi channel with that. But so that is important.
We want walls. We want you to have them.
Give me this idea of the wolf at the wolf saying, I don't have a bed for less than $20,000.
It's pretty much, that's about the rate.
Well, you know, wolves gotta eat too, so.
Hey, that's right. Wolves gotta eat.
David, all right. Now, everybody here on this panel is privileged. They're in the inner circle, and they have all seen the final quest in development, and they've seen stuff you guys haven't seen yet. So don't hunt them down and kidnap them or anything afterwards. But
please.
Yeah, we shouldn't have told them because now wait a minute. When one of them caves in and tells, not only do we have to kill that person, we have to kill you. And there are a lot of you.
Okay, just give us a hint.
And you know, we're efficient, but we're not bad.
But what I want to sort of have David as the last speaker on the panel is, do you have one or two words that sum up your reaction to what you saw?
Careful, boy. You know that I'm very verbose, and yeah. Asking me for one or two words is not easy, but...
You can be more verbose as long as it's completely circumspect.
Yes, of course. I'm not going to give it to you. I would say, wow, and holy crap, and oh my god. Those would be, I know they're not, you know, three words, but yeah, I had the... like amazing fortune to be visiting Wendy a couple weeks ago. I was in Los Angeles for work, and whenever I'm in LA, I always look Wendy up and spend some time with her. And I just happened to be there when she was finishing the last pages of the final quest. And I just happened
to be there. The prologue, not the
final. Oh yes, sorry, just the prologue, the final quest special that's going to be coming out in October from Dark Horse. And I just happened to be there while she was finishing the artwork, and I happened to be there when she and Richard had their sort of final conference call, kind of reviewing the pages. And I'm a fan, like all of you guys, and like all of you guys too. And so the fact that I was allowed to sort of be there, my head is still kind of spinning about that. So thank you guys for welcoming me and all of us so openly into your world and making us part of it. But that the experience of seeing ElfQuest actually being birthed was really amazing. And I guess the biggest takeaway that I can share with you guys is that I think a lot of fantasy worlds are envisioned in a kind of brick by brick kind of way. Like, you know, imagine a story being built from the ground up, and there are all these pieces and this foundation, and it's this sort of solid thing that every piece is weighted on top of what's before it. And I don't think that ElfQuest is created that way. What I saw was way more organic than that. And the best sort of metaphor that I can think of is that the process of the creation of ElfQuest really is like a plant, you know, growing new limbs and following the sun and growing where the soil is most rich. Yeah, and bonsai, pruning what doesn't need to be there. I feel like Wendy and Richard will, as they're allowing the ElfQuest to grow where it will, they're not afraid to lop off a branch if it's not working anymore. Or they're not afraid to fertilize one area if that's where they feel it needs to go. The other metaphor or description that I use to describe it is, it's kind of like the scroll of colors. Again, it's not necessarily this kind of like rigid, set in stone kind of thing, but it's this kind of swirling magic and light that just kind of all happened in front of me. And I think when you guys see the, at least this this first chapter, you'll see without giving anything away, some of the conclusions, maybe not conclusions, you'll see there's a lot of threads that come into this prologue that will answer a lot of questions for you and set the stage for the rest of the final quest. So I will stop there.
Yeah, you better.
Yeah.
What we would like to do is turn over the last, I guess, third of this. You must have some questions. You all better have some questions. We got a room full of ElfQuest people here. You certainly have some questions. Wendy and I, you know what we do. Rob is our local Joseph Campbell stand-in. Paula and Stephanie are our shepherds into the wild new worlds that they're taking us into. And David is our wolf wrangler and naturalist.
Dirty keeper.
So please ask any of us anything you want. Now, I'm told, well...
It would be great if there was a mic.
I'm told there's a roving mic, but there may not be, so if you stand up...
There's a stand, but no mic.
...and talk loud, we'll do the best we can. Here.
Mic!
Is there a mic?
There is a mic.
Hey,
mic.
My name is Andre Miller, and I am from Memphis, Tennessee.
Wait a minute, I'm from Memphis.
Very loudly so everybody can hear me. I do this as a professional. But I cannot tell you how freaking awesome it is to be standing right here, right now, talking to Richard and Wendy Pini. The very first time I picked up a Warp Graphics novel and read ElfQuest, I got it. You mentioned the lady who outed you. No, she didn't out you. I knew, I recognized that storyline of creation and the myth and the mythology and how we are seeking, you know, meaning in a world of family and all that. You inspired me, both of you inspired me to do more with my ability and my gift that I have been given. And I would just like to say thank you.
Oh.
You guys are awesome. And I am so looking forward to everything and anything that you produce. You just do not know what you have done for the little boy from Memphis, Tennessee, way back when, and thank you again.
Thank you. We have discovered...
I think I can be heard.
Right, but they have put a microphone there, and
Good, come on.
My first?
Yeah. Oh, you know.
I just want to know why the hell you haven't been on television a long time ago.
You know what?
I mean, I've watched some shows and I know how difficult it is, but God, you've got it.
That's the question of the ages. And when we have an answer, you'll be
How about telling pitching this and the problems he run into?
Right, I mean, we can answer that a little bit. Up until recently, it had only been attacked as a movie for many, many years. So maybe recently it's been done as a TV show. Maybe it's a serial format after all, but yeah, so.
And it's only been looked at as one movie.
One movie is what people have done.
Which impresses so much of its uniqueness and originality and all the characters down into a format,
and it loses a lot
of its shine, and the characters that you fall in love with get eliminated. You know, the Lord of the Rings, that trilogy, that's changed the landscape, and we're very lucky. And now they're out of the point of years, Tolkien stuff.
So yes, we would like to tell the story as well.
I think people are getting tired of zombies and vampires.
Yes.
Before the next question, I want to introduce somebody who just snuck in. Remember in the show, I said that we love working with wonderful people. And the first project that I mentioned was the two art books, the art of ElfQuest and Line of Beauty, which is the art of Wendy. And we are partnered with a publisher called Flesk Publications, and they said they do some of the most beautiful art books that I have ever seen. I would like the owner, manager, creative force behind Flesk Publication, John Fleskus, to stand up. I see you. Publishers, you send them something, they would package it and put it out there. We are looking forward over the next year and a half, 2 years, whatever it takes, to working very closely with John. He is as much invested in this as we are. Thank you.
And shameless plug, you should head to the Flesk booth because there is a fabulous teaser of some of these upcoming books. And you guys are 1509 or 1519, 1521? Okay. If you have not been by the ElfQuest booth to see some of what's in that teaser booklet, you should, and then you should go over to the Flesk booth and buy it because there's a very limited number of them. They're going like hotcakes from what I understand. Wendy has signed them. And they're just a sample of some of the artwork that you're going to see in these two amazing books. It's not the actual art that's going to be in them, but it's just something to sort of whet your appetite. So definitely you want to check that out.
Now you know why we have human art.
It's not so much a question as it's more of a comment. I actually first read ElfQuest, a friend handed it to me back when I was in middle school, and it had a very profound effect on me, and it actually made me want to create my own worlds and actually pursue writing as a career. And I wanted to thank you for actually make me realize that I wanted to be a storyteller instead of just being a reader.
Well, thank you. Kids, we opted not to have children because we have given our lives and energy to ElfQuest for 35 years, and high ones willing, another 35. But, oh, such a look I just got. but anytime somebody says, you inspired me, or you helped me, or anything like that, you're our kids. You are our spiritual and creative and artistic and wonderful kids. And thank you all, just, you know, for being that. Okay.
I have to have a question for Stephanie and Paula. What kind of new ideas are you going to be bringing to this world, and are you taking on issues?
Love the costume. That was under Make a Bang. We, as you know, probably are new media storytellers, producers of a lot of web content, which put us in contact with a lot of Hollywood execs as well as new media execs, and so we've been picking the brains of everyone we could and gotten some really amazing responses. So although we would always keep the heart as fans, same, and we want to tell the same stories that exist that you all love as well.
We very much want to stay true to the canon, but when you change mediums, sometimes not everything works.
Right.
But we will do our best.
We're going to spread into many mediums and keep the canon the same while filling in the gaps of canon that maybe hasn't been expressed. Like, how did Dushan and Scudder fall in love? Let's look at that story too.
I want to know.
Right? New ways of storytelling that build on the existing stories and take it into traditional as well as new media realms.
And maybe even go down the names, like we said, of characters we haven't gotten to spend as much time with as we would have liked.
And auditions? Oh, good lord, I hope so. I hope I get to audition too.
Me too.
But yeah, stay tuned. We will definitely keep people posted. We're easy to stalk online.
I just want to add one thought to that, but that's exactly what I was talking about ElfQuest's creative process being very organic. You know, Wendy and Richard know the story, but they don't have every last minutia planned out the way that a lot of people think fantasy worlds should be built. And I think that is an amazing, awesome thing. I think it's a huge strength of ElfQuest. And, you know, Wendy doesn't know how Scatter and Dushan fell in love. Well, let's have Paula and Stephanie tell us that. They're amazing, creative people. And they have something to add to this big, you know, quilt that is ElfQuest. And so
I, for one, you know, I want to see that, and I want to see.
And David will not leave you alone, girls. It's, I promise you.
What's that? I won't leave them alone.
But if you have ideas, if you have something that has always come to you, let us know. We love to hear from fellow fans, and we're looking at so many really cool opportunities right now and avenues that that we will definitely take it all into consideration.
Well, this goes directly back to what Rob said, and. That it's a journey from within, it's a quest from within. And as we go through life, finding our own path, you don't know the directions. You may know directions a little way down the road, but you can be persuaded to take a different course. You can choose to take a different course. And that's exactly how we tell the story. It is organic, it grows, and I guess that's why it's as
well.
It's unique.
Also, things hit us right out of the blue, and we have our gut responses to those things, and very often the influence from that goes into ElfQuest. And you're going to see a lot of that in the final quest. I highly recommend that you always have Kleenex handy.
You will be.
It could be cry for happy. Or it could be cry for other reasons, but it is going to be a very, very emotional ride for all of us.
And yeah, it hints that maybe sometimes we come at you with, to not give anything away, but hint to some fun stuff. We often call up Wendy and Richard and they're like, hey, do you guys like video games? Do you like apps? Do you read? Like, just, you know, all sorts of random things we throw at them just to see what they're, with how they feel about certain areas and moving into that for the storytelling.
We got one more question.
Yes.
Oh yes, I have a few quick questions before I do.
Get it. Oh, you can raise that.
Yeah.
Oh, how do
you be a giraffe?
It's okay. I have a few quick questions before I do. I just wanted to say, great work. I first started reading ElfQuest when I was a little kid, and I normally read all Marvel and DC, but I picked up this graphic novel. I think it was when they first went to the cave and, you know, met and encountered Winwell, and it was great. I got my mother and my middle sister into it. They read ElfQuest now because I read it and gave it to them. You guys do fantastic work, and I just have nothing, you know, but good things to say about what you've created. I was just curious for Richard and Wendy, which of your characters you created do you think kind of embodies your personality the best?
That's easy.
That's very easy. And everybody guesses wrong the first time.
Yeah.
They think Cutter and Mita.
Okay.
They're wrong. It's Cutter and Skywise.
Oh, okay.
And before we lose time, because we're coming up on a couple of minutes here, we have Cutter and we have Alita.
Yes.
Would you two stand up?
And on top of that, we have the ultimate fantasy representation of a magical unicorn.
Never put a unicorn or a dragon in ElfQuest, but you have been witness to a unicorn in an ElfQuest panel. Yeah.
It would be the kind I would design.
One more?
A couple questions.
One more,
where do we get your t-shirts from?
Yeah!
The company is called We Love Fine.
We Love Fine, and there are two booths.
Right down in the...
Well, two locations.
Yeah.
Exhibition hall.
One is at the very left corner of the, you know, when you go into the exhibition hall, go to the very far left corner. That's one of their booths. Go to the very end of the 1200 row, they have a bigger booth there.
There's one outside across the street, too.
They don't have any of the ElfQuest ones.
Nope. People are very desperate for the Doctor Who's backpack.
Yes, there's a pop-up shop at the Gas Lamp Hilton, and if you buy a purchase now, they are giving away a ElfQuest button, a limited edition.
Only at the 1200.
Yes, and that is 1245.
35.
Thank you.
And welovefine.com, you can find all of them in women's sizes as well. They didn't have women's sizes here. We have lots of
online women's sizes.
Online, and small ones, big ones, every size.
One last question.
Pike, if you're responsible for that, aren't you, Pike? You're just what? Making trouble again.
What am I doing? What am I doing now?
Don't mess up your t-shirts. You're responsible, aren't you?
Very quickly, because I see somebody walking over there.
Okay. You said before, you two ladies, that you were open to people sending you ideas for stories, whatever. Where would they send those to, or email them to?
Well, you can go to my website, which is thestephaniethorpe.com,
okay.
And it's info at there, and you can get in touch with me that way.
And I'm Paula, or official PaulaRhodes.com is what it can be, but you can find us on Twitter as well. That's probably very quick.
Twitter, Facebook, ElfQuest.com, and we have a POTS sign being flashed. we need to stop, and so thank you all for sharing this.